What is the origin and age of the universe? What is the oldest book in the world, and what does it and other sacred books and scientific journals say about the creation of the cosmos and the earth? What are the origins of life? Is Darwin's theory of evolution through natural selection true? Is this theory a threat to Christianity? These and many other questions are answered in this series, Truth Revealed, produced by Reasons to Believe Fresno Chapter in California. I'm Brad Lopez, your host, and welcome to Answers to Your Questions. Reasons to Believe's mission is to spread the Christian gospel by demonstrating sound reason and the very latest scientific discoveries that consistently support the truth of the Bible and the faith in the personal, transcendent God revealed in both Scripture and science. Hi, I'm Brad Lopez. This is another session of Truth Revealed in Fresno, California, here at People's Church, produced by CMAC. And we are here to hear Ken Samples, a world-renowned national and international speaker and author. And the title is very exciting, Christian's Best Explanation of Reality. So here we go with the crew as we start to put things together.
Hello friends, my name is Trevor Rees, and I have with me right here the pastor of People's Church, one of the pastors here. And as a pastor here at People's Church, what do you do?
Yeah, my name's Brent Duffenbacher. I'm the Family Life pastor at People's Church. Our lead pastor, Deloquist, is not here this evening, but he and I were having a conversation not too long ago about how we could continue to add a depth to our faith and our understanding, and especially as it related with our college group. And so my role as Family Life pastor is I get the opportunity to work and oversee the teams of people with our children, our students, our college age young adults, and our young families. On behalf of our lead pastor, Pastor Deloquist, I wanted to welcome you all to People's Church. For those of you who are guests from around the area, from the region, my name is Brent, and I'm one of the pastors here, and I get to be here a lot of Thursday evenings as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open us in prayer, and then we're just going to go ahead and together, we're going to praise our King. Would you join me in prayer? Let's pray. So God, we thank you that you are good, and your mercies are new every morning, afternoon, and evening, and day, and day, and day. God, I thank you that we get to come together, a group of people that maybe would not normally come together, but we get to come together and we get to hear about you, and we get to have just a confidence and an assurance, God, as we leave here knowing that our faith is alive and it is grounded, and God, it is in an unwavering promise that you've made from beginning to end. So God, tonight, we just thank you. We know that your presence is here with us, and we gather together now, and we lift high the name of Jesus. We pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Spirit that makes it possible. Amen? Amen. If you would, go ahead and stand up with us as we sing a couple songs.
Thank you, G. Thank you, worship team. Good evening, everybody. Hey, my name is Trevor, and I'm the college director here at People's Church, so I get to work really closely with Pastor Brent Duffenbacher over here, who you met just a few minutes ago. Like he mentioned, we normally have our college gathering tonight, but we are blessed to be able to host this event, partnering with Reasons to Believe, and it is my pleasure to introduce to you our speaker for this evening, Professor Ken Samples.
Well, good evening to everybody. Thank you for coming out. It's a pleasure to be with you. Let me begin with a little bit of a story, if you will. How many of you can recognize, let's get the slide up there on screen. There it is. How many of you recognize that image? Anybody? Is there anybody old enough in here? Who is it? It's Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes was the fictional British detective that solved all of these mysterious crimes. If you don't remember that, think CSI, crime scene investigator type of thing. Well, let me put this into your mind as we begin to talk about this topic. If you're a detective and you walk onto a crime scene and you see the dead body, maybe you see a pistol laying there, some bullet wounds, and you look at all of this data, as a policeman, you're going to be asked, what happened here? What is the best explanation of what happened here? How did all of this happen? Well, the best explanation of a crime scene means that that's probably what's true. That's what truly happened. And so I'm going to talk about Christianity's best explanation of reality. Lots of religions and philosophies try to explain reality. I'm going to argue tonight that Christians have the best explanation. And because they have the best explanation, that means that Christianity is highly plausible. So we come to know the Lord because the Holy Spirit opens our hearts. But we also use our minds. And I want to say something about thinking. Jesus said, love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Now, Jesus was a Jew, and even though the New Testament was written in Greek, I think Jesus is really using some Hebrew parallelism here. He's saying not that you can divide a person into heart, mind, soul, and strength as if there are four parts to us. I think what Jesus meant was, love God with every faculty you have. Love Him with everything that you are. Now, neuroscientists say that the most complex mechanism in the known universe, there's nothing more complex than the human brain-mind relationship. And you have one of those. God's given you a good mind. He's given you a brain. Using that mind to love Him means becoming a careful, reflective thinker. There are lots of challenges to our faith. And the better equipped we are at thinking, the better we are. Now, Dr. Geisler, Norman Geisler, is a leading Christian apologist. Notice what he says. Thinking is not an option for the Christian. It's an imperative. Because our mind is one of those tools that God has given us to help us discover the truth. And so we're going to do a little logic lesson here this evening. I'm going to talk about logic. I teach logic at Biola University in Southern California. And we're going to think through our faith a little bit tonight. And then we'll have some time later for question and answers. We also have a book table at the back. And I'll talk about reasons to believe just a little bit later. Now, the Ten Commandments are what I would call moral virtues. Don't lie. Don't steal. Don't murder. Don't commit adultery. Those are moral virtues. What we often don't recognize, however, is the Bible also talks about intellectual virtues. The New Testament says that discerning, being able to think and discern what is good, what is bad, what's right, what is wrong, that's a very valuable virtue. Reflection, testing, analysis, mental renewal, all of these are intellectual virtues. And that's where I think our church needs a lot of help. If I can be candid with you, I think evangelical churches do pretty well at teaching the moral virtues, but not good enough at teaching the intellectual virtues. And here's an example of that. Notice that this is a passage in Acts 17, verse 11. So Luke is the author of the book of Acts. And Luke says, now the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. When I first read that passage, I was taken aback. You mean there are certain Christians that are more noble than other Christians? Yeah. The Bereans were more noble in character than the Thessalonians. Why? Because Paul would go in there, he would open up the Old Testament, because when Paul was preaching, there wasn't yet a New Testament. That had to be written a little later. And the Bereans, they checked sources. They opened up the Old Testament and said, is what this guy's saying, does it really cash out? So there's virtue in being careful, checking sources, thinking about your faith. Here's another passage. This time it's Paul. It's John in 1 John 4:1. John says, "Dear friends, don't believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they're from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world." There is the religion of Islam. There is the religion of Buddhism and Hinduism. There's atheistic naturalism. Go on the web. There's virtually any religion or philosophy right at your fingertips. John says, don't believe every spirit. You need to be discerning. There are certain people who teach the truth and others who teach a counterfeit. The use of that mind, the most complex, imagine having the most complex mechanism as a gift from God, and you're lazy. You don't use it. You don't recognize this wonderful gift the Lord has given us. So discerning, testing things. Here's another passage. Paul says, test everything and hold on to the good. Test everything? Well, the context of the passage is prophets would go into the apostolic church and they would give a prophetic word. And what does the apostle Paul says? Test what they say and hold on to the good, meaning some of what they say may not be so good. All of this involves our mind. All of this involves what I would call, again, intellectual virtues. I told my son one time, the Lord, his name's Michael, I said, Michael, the Lord can be as pleased with you when you're thinking about a mathematics problem as he is when you're praying. Why? Because the Lord is the one who has given us that mind. Using our minds, being careful, reaching our potential, if you will. Now let's look at four worldviews. A worldview is your big picture view of the world and life. It's how you think about things like God and morality and truth. Well, I think those four images reflect the four major worldviews. Everybody has a worldview. How do you get it? Most people inherit it from their parents. Sometimes they trade it in and get a different worldview, but everybody has a worldview. Everybody has to make sense of God. Everybody has to ask, what's life about? How should I live my life? Well, there are four images there. Of course, the cross represents historic Christianity. Probably not the oldest symbol. Probably the oldest symbol is a fish. But Christians have a view of God. God is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The Father sent his Son into the world to die for human sin. He rose from the dead. These are those essential Christian beliefs that we hold. But notice the second symbol. It's a crescent moon with a star. Anybody recognize that symbol? It's the symbol of Islam. And the Pew Research, who look into statistics, they say that there may be 1.6, 1.7 billion Muslims in the world. In fact, some of the best research indicates that if you add up the number of Christians, and here we're being very generous, all the denominations, Catholic, Orthodox, Protestant, all the non-denominational, Lutheran, Methodist, etc. If we add them all up together, it's about 2.2 billion Christians. If Islam is 1.6, maybe 1.7, depending on the stats, if you add the two, you've got about 55% of the world's population. More than half of the world is made up of Christians and Muslims. What if there was deep hostility between the two? That would envelop virtually the entire world. Islam has its own view of God, Allah. And Islam denies the doctrine of the Trinity. They say the Trinity, that's polytheism. You believe in three gods. They don't believe that Jesus was God in human flesh. They don't believe Jesus died on the cross. They don't believe that human beings are fallen. If you are in Islam, you believe that human beings are born pure. Well, I think all you have to do is take a careful look in the mirror and you realize that human beings have a sin problem. A third image up there, does anybody recognize the circle with the white and the black? Anybody? It's the yin-yang symbol, which is really the symbol for a particular religion called Taoism, but I'm investing it with more. I'm going to say that's all of the Eastern religions. That's Hinduism, that's Buddhism, that's Taoism, Confucianism, etc. Think of a pantheistic god. That is, the world is God. All reality is one, and that one reality is God. Now, not all Hindus are pantheists. In fact, you might find it a surprise to realize that most Hindus actually believe in one God. They're bhakti Hindus. Most of them believe that Krishna is that one God. And so again, they have a very different view about God and the world. And then lastly, notice that the fish has grown feet. And it has a particular name. I'm going to let that represent secularism. That's atheistic naturalism. That's the view that says God is a myth. God is an illusion. The world is the only reality. There's no invisible God. There's no invisible soul. Human beings have evolved. Notice that we've got competitors. We've got worldview competitors up there. And the only way you're going to be able to track them, by the way, is if you think and discern and reflect. They all have different views of God, different views of salvation. So thinking and discerning and developing your intellectual skills is really critical. So naturalism would be the fish. Nature is the sole reality. That's atheism. Pantheism says all is God and God is all. That's especially part of the religion of Hinduism and others. Islamic theism, they believe in a personal God, although I would argue you can't know Allah. Allah is not a God you can have a personal relationship with. Quite frankly, the only God you can have a personal relationship with is a God who comes down to earth and takes on human nature. As Christians, we call that the incarnation. A carnivore is someone who eats flesh. Jesus came in the flesh. And if you look into the eyes of the Lord Jesus Christ, you see everything that God is. Jesus is the manifestation of God in human flesh. And so those are the four major worldviews, and they're all competing. They're all vying for people's attention. And so let's talk a little bit about logic. And I want to say, by the way, that Christians should feel very comfortable with logic. Number one, because we believe God gave us our mind and our brain. And a few years ago, I had a brain illness, and I had an MRI on my brain, and the technician said, Ken, would you like to see your brain? And I thought, yeah, I mean, Plato and Aristotle never saw their brain. So he showed it to me, and my first thought is, I thought it would be bigger. Pride can be a problem, right? Why should Christians be comfortable with logic? One, because the good Lord has given us all a healthy brain mind, the most complex mechanism in the known universe. But think back to the Gospel of John. John starts chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word. And guess what Greek word is translated for our English word? Logos. You can translate that verse in the beginning was logic. You could, because Jesus is the logic of God. Jesus is the rationality of God. Jesus is the thought of God. He's the speech of God. And so John is telling us, wow, we've all worshiped Yahweh, but now we have the Messiah, and he is Yahweh in human flesh. So Christians ought to feel comfortable with logic. Now, the father of logic is a man named Aristotle. Aristotle lived about 400 years before Christ. Aristotle, of course, was not the first one to think logically, but he was the first to set up principles of logic so that we could study it systematically. And by the way, notice what he calls logic. He says it's a tool. It's an instrument to do what? To help you and me, to help us discover the truth. Well, if logic is a tool to help us discover truth, it's a valuable tool. And Christians believed that thinking is the good gift of the good Lord. And quite frankly, churches do a good job teaching moral values. We really need to improve in teaching intellectual virtues. Because you have more competition now than I had when I was a young person. The web opens up the entire world at your fingertips. And if you're not discerning and if you're not careful, there are counterfeits out there. And again, these worldviews, they are sucking people in. So you not only want to discern what's true and what's false, but I hope you also want to reach out to people that are trapped in these counterfeit religions and philosophies and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right. Now, I want to talk about an argument, and I know you all know what an argument is because it's what you get into with your boyfriend or girlfriend, right? You argue. No, it's not a verbal fight. In logic, you can be very calm. Your jugular vein doesn't have to be popping out. You don't have to be angry. To argue, you need two things, and an argument is a very simple thing. You make a claim. You say something is true or something is a fact, and then you provide support for it. So you make a claim and you give support for it. That's an argument. If you make a claim and you don't have any support, you have an opinion. And opinions are fine. My wife tells me I have a lot of opinions. But opinions don't prove anything. Opinions are just what you happen to think. You need some support. Now, if all you have is support, then you just have a lot of information and data. But to have a logical argument, you have to say, look, Jesus Christ rose from the dead. That's my claim. That's my conclusion. Now I'm going to give you some evidence for that. I'm going to appeal to the empty tomb. I'm going to appeal to the fact that the Apostle Paul says more than 500 people saw Jesus at once. I'm going to appeal to various facts. So an argument is to make a claim and then to seek support for the claim. Now let's tie this into this idea of explanation. How well does a worldview explain the facts of reality? We call that power. And how wide is the range of its explanation? That's its scope. I'm going to argue this evening, briefly, but I hope forcefully, that Christianity makes the best explanation of the world. It explains why there's a universe. It explains why there's good and bad. It explains the person of Jesus Christ. It explains you and me as fallen sinners. Christianity has a way of explaining all of these things. And logicians would say the better the explanation, the more likelihood that you've got the truth. So a good worldview will explain a broad variety of data, important data. The more profound the explanatory power, the greater assurance that one is in fact encountering a truthful vision. So you walk on the crime scene and the detective is looking at the dead body. It's looking for bullet holes. It wants to know, is the furniture disrupted? What happened here? What is the best explanation? Because that's likely to be true. And then they're going to arrest somebody and they're going to prosecute that person. And they can only make their case with the jury if they've got solid information. Well, that's the way we look at worldviews. Police officers reason this way. Detectives reason this way. And I'll talk about a few other people here in just a moment. Now, here's Robert Harris. Robert Harris is a Christian. And he talks about a worldview, and he uses my example. He says when detectives examine a crime scene, their goal is to develop a narrative, that's a story, right? of events, a story that explains as many details of evidence as possible in as plausible a way as possible. In other words, they develop a hypothesis that covers the facts. That's the way all intelligent people reason. They're looking for an explanation of the data. Harris continues. He says, similarly, a worldview might be seen as a hypothesis that aims to take into account as many of the observed phenomena of the world, life, and experience as possible in a coherent, unified way. The more phenomena that can be reasonably and plausibly explained by a given hypothesis, the greater is that hypothesis's explanatory power. So just as detectives go on the crime scene, just as attorneys reason this way, by the way, doctors reason this way. You go in, you have an illness, they take tests, right? They look for symptoms, and then they draw a diagnosis based upon that data. They're essentially saying, I think that a particular disease explains everything that I see here. Doctors reason this way. My father was an automobile mechanic, and I remember being a boy, my dad would tune up people's cars as a way of kind of helping them out. In fact, he knew who all the widows were whose husbands had died in the church or in the neighborhood, and he'd tune up their car for them. And I remember these old ladies would pull up into the driveway, and my dad would just listen to the engine. He wouldn't touch anything, didn't take any tools out. He would just listen to the engine, and he would diagnose what the problem was. When I was a boy, I thought, wow, my dad's a shaman. I mean, how many other people have a father who could just listen to a car and tell, he doesn't even have to look at anything. Well, my dad wasn't a shaman. My dad knew enough about the internal combustion engine to know that certain problems gave evidence like symptoms. Carburetor problem, transmission problem. Why? Because he was like a doctor. In fact, my father was the diagnosis guy. Whenever they had a really difficult problem with an engine, call Ken's dad in here, and he'll diagnose that. Anybody who's involved in diagnosis is reasoning this way. We call this abductive reasoning. How many of you have heard of abductive reasoning? Any of you? Now, I'm going to tell you what it's not. It's not an alien coming from space and abducting you and taking you away. That's a different kind of abduction. Abductive arguments are arguments that attempt to arrive at the best explanation. Again, explanation. The best explanation of an event or a given series of facts. So it's different than deductive reasoning and inductive reasoning. It lacks certainty, unlike deduction. Yields probable truth like induction, but it doesn't seek to predict unlike induction. So abductive reasoning is a special way of reasoning where you're essentially asking, what's the best explanation? How did the universe get here? Why is the universe seemingly so designed? Why is it that the universe has qualities and characteristics that allow for human life to exist? We call that the habitable zone. We call that the anthropic principle. Why are human beings the way they are? Blaise Pascal, the brilliant French scientist and thinker, he said human beings are great and wretched. He said human beings are great and wretched, and he said Christianity explains that. You're great because you are made in the image of God. You're the only species on the planet that reads. You're the only species on the planet that can do mathematics. This uniqueness, this greatness, the Bible says human beings are exceptional. They're not only different in degree, different in kind, but Pascal said we're not only great, we're wretched. Stop being selfish. Just stop it. Stop putting yourself. Jesus says, love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. And if you do that every moment of your life, then you can stand before God and be accepted into heaven. But the problem that we all have is selfishness. rather than loving God and my neighbor, I love myself. I'm curved in on myself. The Bible uses lots of descriptions of sin. One metaphor is like an archer and the arrow misses the target. Another image is that we're commandment breakers. God gives us commandments and we break them. So it's not just a sin to commit adultery. According to the New Testament, it's a sin to have sexual fantasies, to lust. It's not just a sin to murder someone, but the Bible says to carry, to harbor hate in our hearts means that we're guilty before God. Pascal says we're great and wretched. Islam doesn't say that. Islam says human beings. Now, this is a question I have, and I'm going to address it in another church tomorrow night. Islam has a lot of violence within its history, but it's a religion that teaches that people are born good. What kind of explanatory power does that have? So again, here are the three forms of reasoning. Here are the three types of logical reasoning. Deductive, it's like reasoning from geometry. It's reasoning from what we call modus ponens and modus tollens. Your goal is to have certain conclusions. That's great reasoning. The problem is most areas don't apply to deduction. Most of you are familiar with induction. That's where you try to prove something with probability. That's what scientists are usually attempting to do. Mathematical arguments are deductive. Scientific arguments are inductive, but tonight we're looking at abductive. So instead of certainty or probability, we're talking plausibility. But guess what? When you go on the crime scene and the detective collects the evidence and then talks to the district attorney and gives them that evidence, and then the district attorney brings charges against the person, that person can be put to death or be put in prison for the rest of their life based upon the most plausible explanation of what happened at the crime scene. See, that's what I'm arguing tonight with you. I'm arguing Christianity is the most plausible explanation of reality, and because it is, I think it's true. There's good reason to believe that it's true. Now, here is the New World Encyclopedia. I like it because it's clear, it's careful. They say abduction. Now, again, not taking the UFO abduction, different kind of abduction. Abduction, or inference to the best explanation, is a method of reasoning in which one chooses the hypothesis that would, if true, best explain the relevant evidence. Abductive reasoning starts from a set of accepted facts and infers the most likely or best explanations. Who reasons this way? Detectives, doctors, lawyers, mechanics, historians. In fact, one philosophy encyclopedia says this seems to be the fundamental way that all intelligent people reason about anything. Now, this is why I think that this is important. Because occasionally I will debate atheists and agnostics and skeptics, and I'll debate Muslims and Hindus and Mormons and virtually anybody who wants to engage in the question of the truth of Christianity. And they often think, well, you Christians, you have your magical way of reasoning. And I say, oh, no. We don't reason magically. I'm going to reason about the truth of Christianity the way all intelligent people reason. I'm going to use the same type of reasoning that doctors and lawyers and policemen and mechanics and engineers and scientists reason. We don't have to reason magically. There's good evidence that what we believe is true. And it's not enough just to tell people, well, Jesus has changed my life, even though that's a wonderful testimony. People at some point are going to ask you, I know that he seems to have changed your life, but how do I know that's true? And that's when we engage in what we call apologetics. So abductive reasoning is reasoning to the best explanation. We evaluate it based upon, is it coherent? Is it internally logical? Does it correspond to the facts? Does it balance complexity and simplicity? And does it avoid unwarranted presumption? Does it accommodate possible counter evidence? Does it possess genuine explanatory power and scope? And all of those things go into what we call abductive reasoning. And again, the best way of thinking it is this: it's the way a diagnostician reasons. Scientists use it when they develop a hypothesis. So you're moving from facts or data or evidence to a coherent, plausible explanation. And here are all those intelligent people who reason this way. And again, I think this is the normal, natural way people reason. Here's another example for you. Suppose it's Friday night. You don't have work or school on Saturday morning, so you sleep in. You're kind of groggy, you're starting to wake up, and you peek through the blinds, and you notice that the streets are wet. What's the first thing that pops? What pops into your mind naturally, intuitively, and immediately when you see the streets are wet? It must have rained. Why? Because God has made us creatures who are looking for explanations of reality. Now, of course, in my neighborhood, the second Tuesday, the street sweeper comes, so you got to take that explanation into account. But that's the way we think. We're looking for explanations. Now, I'm going to skip ahead just a tiny bit here. So what kinds of things can we use this? Well, how about explaining Jesus? What's the best explanation for the life of Jesus? Was he just a man? Was he a myth? How about a madman? I personally think that Jesus' siblings, particularly James, who later wrote the book of James, and maybe even Mary, the mother of Jesus, at some point I think I've got good reason to believe this from the New Testament, they thought Jesus was a bipolar. They thought Jesus was seriously mentally ill. How many people do you know who go around telling people they're Yahweh? And then James saw the resurrection. He saw the resurrected Christ. He went from thinking his brother, can you imagine the embarrassment? James is a good Jew, and his brother's going around claiming to be the Messiah. Think of the man. And can you imagine growing up in a family with Jesus? Can't you be more like Jesus? What's wrong with you? Well, is he a madman? Most people who tell me they're God, I wonder, are they taking their medication? Man, myth, madman, is he a menace? Was Jesus an evil thing? By the way, Jesus let people worship him. Jesus claimed to be God. If he isn't, he's an evil man. Good people don't let other people worship them. Good people don't go around saying, you're only going to be accepted by God if you believe in me. Is that an option? Is it a possible? Was he a mystic? Did he say, I'm God, but we're all God? Is that an option? Was he a Martian? You might laugh at that, but there are UFO religions where people say Jesus came from outer space. Just watch the History Channel. I used to call the History Channel the Hitler Channel because it was always World War II and Hitler. Now it's always abduction and UFOs. Was Jesus a Martian or was he the Messiah? By the way, I really hope you're impressed with all of the M words that I came up with. That took a lot of work to come up with all. I was borrowing that from C.S. Lewis. Is he Lord? Is he liar? Is he lunatic? All I've done is taken Lewis's argument and I've extended the options. What's the best explanation? Because the best explanation is likely the most plausibly true explanation. Or how about the universe? Life on planet Earth. What is the best explanation for the complex life? Life on our planet is teeming. I remember watching a television program about the astronauts that went to the moon. And they said that when they got to the moon and it was lifeless and it was gray and black and dark, and then they looked over their shoulder and they were shocked by Earth with its color, its beauty, and it was teeming with life. Well, what's the best explanation? That God created the life, or that somehow life began purely naturalistically and life evolved? What's the best explanation? Those are the debates that we get into. We can also ask that for all of these things, what's the best explanation of the cosmos, of life, ethics, abstractions, religion? Is it naturalism, atheism, or is it Christian theism? Now, let me go through quickly some areas, and then we'll turn it over to our pastor here, and we can have a little Q&A. I'm going to argue that Christianity makes the best case. It's a cumulative case. Now, look at cosmology. Big Bang cosmology, with its singular beginning to the universe, corresponds well with the historic Christian doctrine of creation ex nihilo. Now, some Christians are a little uneasy about Big Bang cosmology. They think it's secular. But you know what? There are a lot more people that are uneasy with Big Bang cosmology. They're called atheists. Because if the universe popped into existence, then the most reasonable question is, why? How? Where did it come from? And Christians believe in creation ex nihilo, that there was only God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and God called all other things into existence out of nothing. Well, that looks a lot like Big Bang cosmology. How about physics? The fundamental constants of physics appear fine-tuned to allow for human life. We call this the anthropic principle. Here's the image in your mind. Imagine somebody going up to a screen and there are all of these dials that you have to dial in just delicately. All of these dials where you have to tune them in to allow for the emergence of human life. The complexity of physics has to be just right. Well, that fits really well with God, the great physicist, God, the great mathematician, God who has dialed in everything, a world in which you and I can live and thrive and live out our destiny. How about intelligibility? You know, this drives a lot of people up the wall who hold atheistic beliefs. They don't know why, if there's no God and the universe is there, why is it that human beings should be able to detect the intelligibility of the universe? Well, a lot of people will say, look, we don't know why. It's this miracle that human beings could somehow understand the universe. But you know what? If a mind made the world, then the world is the product of reason, and God made us in his image. And so, of course, we should be able to track it. That's why when you study hard in school, that's why when you use these faculties that the good Lord has given you, it brings glory to him. Just as when my wife and I see our children do well, we have this enormous sense of pride. Imagine how God the Father feels when he's given you these faculties and then you say, Lord, you've given them to me and I'm going to use them to my very best to bring you glory. Intelligibility, as would be expected, the cosmos was created by a divine mind. The universe is, in large measure, intelligible. That's exactly what you'd expect if there was a God. Congruence, lots of other ones that I just don't have time to talk about all of these, but all of these particular areas seem to be explained the best by not only theism, a personal creator, but by the God of Christian theism. And let me do one more here. Why is there so much beauty in the world? One atheist said, you know, if the world is filled with beauty, that's a really good reason to believe God exists. But it's not just that there's a lot of beauty in the world. It's also that human beings seem to have this capacity to detect beauty, and we crave it, and we love it, In fact, non-religious people, people who don't believe in God or don't go to church, typically they just want the beautiful. Well, I would argue that beauty and elegant theories in the world and in life, they correspond well to the existence of what? A divine artist, a divine mathematician. God's not just a scientist. God is also an artist. And the love we have of beauty comes from being made in his image. And let me close with this. How about love? I was talking to a couple Muslim apologists. Those are Muslims that defend their faith. So we were online and we were going back and forth. And I kept asking them a question. I said, you know, you believe in Allah, and Allah is a single solitary person and being. There's only one God and one person. I said, here's my question for you. Who did Allah love as a single solitary person? Remember, that's different from the Trinity. The Trinity says that there's one God who exists as three distinct persons. The three persons are the one God. The one God are the three persons. Well, I said, now you don't believe in the Trinity. You think that's polytheism. You think it's false. In fact, there is a passage in the Quran that says, desist, do not say that God is one and three. So I said, here's my question for you. Who did Allah love in eternity before he created angels and human beings? And they got really ticked off at me. And the debate went back and forth, and I kept pulling them back and pulling them back. And I said, now listen, the Quran says that one of God's name, he has 99 names in the Quran. One of them is the loving. And it's not narcissistic love. It's not love looking at yourself in the mirror. It's a lover who will love the beloved. It's giving, it's sacrificial. I said, now who did Allah love in eternity? He was alone. And I said, by the way, does that mean he's needy? Does Allah have to create in order to get love? Does Allah have to create to be fulfilled in himself? Because the Quran also says Allah doesn't need anything or anybody. After we went through a long debate, they both got mad at me. They both said I didn't know what the heck I was talking about. And then they apologized to me, and they both said, I don't know who Allah loved in eternity. And I said, you know what? That's okay. There are things I don't know about my faith all that sure either. I said, why don't you go ask an imam? Why don't you go ask another teacher? I did the same thing, by the way, with a couple of guys who were Jewish. And we had a long discussion. I said to them, who did Yahweh love in eternity before he created Gabriel, before he created the angels, and before he created human beings? Because remember, traditional Judaism says God is one being, one person. Traditional Judaism rejects the Trinity. Messianic Jews believe, but they're Jewish in culture and Christian in theology. Both of the Jewish fellows became silent and said, I've never been asked that question before. Well, here's my close. God, the Father, has loved his Son from all eternity, and the one who springs forth from that love. The Father is the lover, the Son or Jesus is the beloved, and what springs forth from that love is the Holy Spirit. God is analogously like a human family. God doesn't need us to get love. It's a loving community from all eternity, the Father loving the Son and the Spirit. And here's the great thing. God doesn't need you, and he doesn't need me. Allah needs you. Yahweh needs you. The Trinity doesn't need us, but here's the great thing. They want us. I remember when my wife wanted to have a baby, I was like, I don't know, you know, do we have saved enough money? Maybe my wife will love the kid more than me, and I want her to love me. You know what? When we had our first daughter, we loved each other more. Our daughter was the product of our love. And it was, my wife and I were willing to sacrifice anything we did for the benefit of our girl. Well, the existence of agape love, unconditional, self-sacrificing love, fits with the existence of the loving, personal God. That's why Christians ought to think and study about the Trinity, because it's the Trinity that teaches us that God can love you and he can love me, even though we don't love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. But this God of love, that is the very foundation of love, that love spills over on all of the people who embrace the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think Christianity is the best explanation. I argue that way in my books. We have a Reasons to Believe table. It's a Christian apologetics ministry that specializes in science and faith. Got lots of books back there. If you want to get on the mailing list, you'll get a free disc. It's my testimony, a philosopher's search for truth. So I hope that you'll go back there and sign up, get some free stuff. The RTB guys, some of them are scientists. They come from all different fields. They'll be happy to talk with you. And I'm going to turn it over to our pastor.
Thank you, Professor Kent. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I do not know everything about Christianity. And I have a whole lot of questions as well. So we are going to have some time for Q&A in about 10 minutes or so. And this is how we're going to do. If you could put up that slide up on the screen. We have a number that you guys can text, and it's this 358-348-7730. And we're going to have a time for Q&A once again in about 10 minutes, so text your questions to that number. All right, so let's get started with this. Professor Ken, so you teach at Biola University. What is one of the biggest questions that college students have about Christianity?
Great question. When I first started doing apologetics is a biblical word. It means giving reasons for your faith. When I first started doing that in the late 70s and early 80s, when I was a college student, the question was, is Christianity true? So I spent a lot of time talking about the resurrection, talking about good reasons why to believe God exists. I think today, maybe not so much at Biola, because Biola is a Christian university, but I think the question has changed. I think lots of college students want to know, is Christianity good? Has Christianity been good for women? Has Christianity been good for minorities? What about the Inquisition? What about the Crusades? What about bad things that have been done in the name of God? Of course, what I would say about that is that there were two people groups, that large people groups that first joined Christianity, do you know what they were? Who were the first two major people groups? Women and slaves. In fact, there are so many women joining the Christian faith, the Romans thought it was a feminist faith. Why? Because remember, even in Judaism, the Jewish fellow would wake up in the morning and say, Lord, I thank you that I'm not a pagan dog. I'm a Jew. I thank you that I'm not a woman. I'm a man. Jesus was extraordinary in drawing attention to the idea that all of the people groups that were marginalized could be redeemed by him. So I think one of the changes I've seen in the last 30 years is people have more questions about, has Christianity been a good force in the world? And I would say absolutely. The Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. was a Baptist minister. And the people supporting civil rights, many of them were supporting it because of their religious convictions. So Christianity has been a good force in the world. Doesn't mean Christians don't do bad things. But I think that's the biggest change I've seen in 30 years.
All right, thank you. So our next question is, how do you explain the Trinity to some that claim to be Christian but don't believe in the Trinity?
I love that question. I wanted to tell you something, by the way. I have never texted in my life. In fact, I have a flip phone. My son said, Dad, the only people who have flip phones are dinosaur philosophers like you and drug dealers. You're here to help me with the text. Let's talk briefly about the Trinity. The Trinity, tri-unity, that's where we get the word Trinity, tri, three, in unity. What we say is that God is three and he's one. Now, some people would say, Muslims would say, that's a contradiction. You're saying God's one and he's not one. You're saying he's three and he's not three. That is a logical contradiction. Jehovah's Witnesses say that. They knock on my door. They say the Trinity is a contradiction. We're not saying that. The Trinity says the way God is one in terms of his being, in terms of his essence, he's not three. And the way God is three in terms of his personhood, he's not one. So the doctrine of the Trinity is not a logical contradiction. A logical contradiction is A cannot equal A and non-A. Now, I'm not saying any of us can fully fathom or totally comprehend the Trinity. God is beyond us. He's infinite. He's eternal. He has all of these incredible qualities and characteristics, and you and I are finite and limited. But technically put, the Trinity is not a logical contradiction. And one more thing. What you don't get with Allah and what you can't get with a single solitary person is a God who is really loving. Because to have love, you have to have a lover and a beloved. And then there is the product of the love that they share. So the Trinity gives you a God of love. And the Trinity is not technically a contradiction. It's a mystery. It's challenging. But you know what? If you could understand God, he wouldn't be much of a God.
All right. So then our next question would be, okay, so I'm a former Mormon and got into apologetics because of its ability to help others think clearly. So how do we know as a guideline when there's enough evidence presented for a successful argument?
Great question. Very thoughtful question. It seems that the way we look at things is we say, look, a good argument is clear. A good argument is careful. A good argument examines enough evidence to know whether you've sufficiently examined the issue. So, obviously, an argument can break down if you haven't done your homework, if you haven't really sufficiently looked at an issue. But I think that we can know we've been reasonable in our thinking and we've been careful in our construction of an argument if we've looked at the major issues. I know what the Jehovah's Witnesses are going to say about the Trinity. I know what the Muslims are going to say about the Trinity. I know what the Mormons are going to say about it, and I know what the atheists are going to say about it, and I think I've got reasonable responses to each and all of those groups. And Christians have been thinking and writing and worshiping the Trinity for 2,000 years. So I think there's a reasonable basis when we've done our homework and we know the major objections and challenges and we're comfortable responding to them.
Right. So you mentioned how God is a loving God about a question ago. And I think this is definitely a relevant question that a lot of people are asking is, if God is a loving God, then why is there so much hurt in the world?
Look at that question up there. In my opinion, that is the question. For most people who walk away from their faith, or most people who don't believe in God or don't believe in the Christian God, it's typically because they see too much pain, too much suffering, too much evil in the world. How could a good God allow all of this? Now, I'm going to say a couple things to that. And again, I've written a couple books that have dealt with that issue, and it's a challenging one. To be candid, it's not always easy to know how to respond to that question. But I'm going to give you a little summary, and you can dig into my books if you're interested in more. The first thing that I want to say about that is, how do I know that there's so much evil in the world? Where did you get your standard of goodness? My father was a combat soldier in the Second World War. His infantry division liberated one of the concentration camps. There were bodies stacked almost two stories high. How do you know what Hitler did to the Jews was wrong? Where did you get your moral standard of goodness? What Hitler did to the Jews isn't wrong unless there's a standard by which the Nazis violated it. Why is it that we intuitively know that there's pain and suffering, and that's not right? So you and I have the problem of suffering. We have the problem of pain. The atheist has the problem of the good. Where did the good come from? Where is the righteous standard that shows us that there's so much pain and suffering in the world? Now, I'm also going to take another tact on this. Nobody likes to suffer. Nobody likes to see other people suffer. But what if, here I'm quoting St. Augustine, the great Christian thinker. Here I'm quoting C.S. Lewis, another great Christian thinker. They said, suffering is a severe mercy. That is, what if God took all the suffering out of the world? You may feel you don't need him at all. Maybe God lets us suffer because that's what drives us back to him. So while suffering, I had a major health crisis 12 years ago. Some of the doctors thought I may have brain cancer, and they told me and my wife, get your house together. Your husband may not make it. Remarkably, I recovered. The doctor looked at my chart and said, somebody must be watching over you. It was the worst time of my life. I felt like I was in the ocean in a riptide. I always pride myself on how I'm a careful thinker. I can work through problems. I had abscess brain lesions. I had meds running through my body. Every other day, I'd ask my poor wife, why am I here? I felt like I was in a prison. But out of that, I met people. I met a guy. I was on a gurney. The nurse brought in a guy in a wheelchair, and our eyes met. I didn't want to look at anybody. I just wanted to lay on the gurney and feel sorry for myself. Our eyes met, and the guy said to me, my doctor told me I have a 6-pound cancer in my stomach. So I was like, what do I do? And I said, you know, I don't know who you are. I don't know your name. I may never see you again. You got cancer in your stomach, and I may have cancer in my brain. But I said, brother, the only one we can trust is Jesus Christ. And he looked at me and he said, I want that. And he started crying. And as soon as the nurses came and swept him away, I don't know what happened to him, where. I began meeting people who had illnesses. I developed a greater sense of empathy and care. So I'm going to challenge you tonight. If God took all the pain and suffering out of this world, you might feel, what do I need with him? Maybe God has a greater good. And is there anything really good in your life that hasn't involved pain and struggle and challenge and difficulty? I love vacations. I love entertainment. I learn nothing from them. It's the challenges of life. So Christians believe God has a greater good. Last point. What was the greatest evil in the world? Well, I'll tell you what it was. God came to earth in human flesh, and human beings crucified their Savior. They spat upon him. They crucified him. Remember, Roman crucifixion, you basically suffocate. But out of the greatest evil where human beings attack their creator, what came out of the death of Jesus? Salvation for all who believe. Out of the greatest evil came the greatest good. So I believe God has good that he brings out of evil. And if you're going to call something evil, tell me where you got the standard of goodness by which evil violates it.
All right, so we'll do about three more questions. So you are an apologist, correct?
Correct.
How does somebody begin to study apologetics, and what are some good resources for us to get started?
Great. I think that apologetics is something all Christians should think about, because you live in a world that's a little different than the world I grew up in. There are more challenges. The web exposes you to more things than I ever dreamed of. Tonight, you can go on the web and talk to Muslims. You can go on the web and talk to Buddhists. You can go on the web and talk to atheists and agnostics and skeptics or anybody you want. They're all there. I think it's important that churches teach people to think carefully, to think critically, to use the intellectual virtues. I would also say that having study groups that go through good material. Now, I'm gonna make a commercial. There's a table in the back of the room. I've spent years writing those books. I've spent years talking to atheists and Hindus and Buddhists and Muslims and trying to come up with thoughtful answers. And so I'm going to recommend not only maybe you consider some of my books as a starting place. And by the way, I try to write books where people who are new to the topic can make their way through it. But more than that, I have lots of science colleagues. I think one of the biggest challenges in our time is, what do we do with evolution? What do we do with the scientific community? And Reasons to Believe has been around for 30 years, giving people reasons to believe. And the table's back there. I hope some people will take advantage of it.
All right. Next question would be, so you've, in your career, you've come across a lot of people who like to argue or like to bring up a lot of, you know, different points and stuff. So how do you deal with somebody who is just looking for an argument, not necessarily a conversation?
Great question. You know, certain people gravitate toward apologetics. Typically, they're people who like to argue. And you know what? You have to be careful as a thinker, because I'll tell you another thing that Christian thinkers can get into trouble. We can struggle with pride. And so being a careful thinker is a prize-worthy thing. And again, He's given you the hardware. He's given you this brain that neuroscientists say we have such a difficult time understanding and figuring out. He's given that to you. Sure, there are people who come up to me and to others, and they want to pick a fight. They want to argue. Their goal is not to have a civil exchange of truth. They just want to play games. Well, I don't know what the Lord's doing in those circumstances. I don't know what's in a person's heart. I have met people that I thought they're not genuine. They're not sincere. They just want to fight with me. And if I discern that's the case, then I'm going to try to give them an answer and maybe begin looking for the person I think is more interested. But I can tell you this, I've known a lot of people who started out where they just wanted to argue with religious people and cause difficulty, and guess what? They got converted. So you never know what's going on in the heart and the mind of other people. Intellectual people tend to be prideful. Intellectual people can have the challenges. But I would say, even if you think you're talking to somebody who doesn't seem to be terribly genuine or very open, then you're praying for that person. Lord, this person seems to be difficult. They don't really seem to be terribly interested. Nobody gets saved apart from the work of the Holy Spirit. The real witness, the real evangelist is the Holy Spirit. We're We're his servants. We serve him. So, yeah, there are difficult people. In fact, there are people who think I'm difficult. Can you imagine that? But I think you discern that, and I think you treat them respectfully and civilly, and you give them an answer, and you keep yourself yourself open to the fact that the Lord may be doing something that you're totally unaware of.
All right, so then our last question of the night is, how do you explain the need for a Savior to somebody who doesn't understand the problem of sin?
Wow, great. Great question. I think one thing you can consider doing is to maybe talk about the different ways that the Bible does talk about sin. The New Testament Greek word for sin is hamartia. And the Bible has a number of metaphors. The Bible has a number of ways of defining sin or describing sin. I touched upon a couple of them in my talk. I think the principal way that the Bible talks about sin is that God has commandments. He is a king and a ruler, and he has his commandments, and we, for the life of us, have not been able to keep them. I think we then begin to explain to people that sin is not just doing wrong things. Maybe you haven't murdered anybody, but how about hatred in your heart? Maybe you've never committed fornication or adultery, but have you ever lusted for someone? That is, sin is a bigger problem. It's not just the things we do. You can sin in your thoughts and in your words and in your deeds. You can sin by what you've done and what you haven't done. And I think we can share that the Bible also talks about missing of the mark. Another metaphor, the archer shoots at the target and misses the mark. Paul in Romans 1 says sin is blindness. People are blind to their sin and to their relationship with the Lord. I think the fundamental sin, however, is selfishness. And I think if we begin to explain to people that God wants us to love others the way we love ourselves, and he wants us to love him above all else, and I think we can begin to ask people, you know, do you love your next door neighbor the way you love yourself? What about the sin of selfishness? When something happens, do you think, what's in it for me? So, yes, it's true. A lot of people think the idea of sin is a quaint idea. Some people don't think in terms of sin and the fall and the righteous standards of God. But I think most thoughtful people, when they begin to think, you might even say, why are human beings so broken? Why is there so much pain in the relationships that we have? Why do we have so much brokenness in our families? Why do we have so many troubles in the world when it comes to the human condition? So, yes, before I was a Christian, I thought there was a God. I thought Jesus might be the Son of God, but I didn't think sleeping with a girl was wrong. I just accepted my ethics as I went forward. I think you can talk to people about sin, maybe by laying out your own sin, maybe by talking about your own brokenness, that you're a commandment breaker, that you've missed the mark, that you have had blindness in your life, and Jesus has come to take away all of those sins, the sins in your thoughts, the sins in your words and the sins in your deeds, what you've done and what you failed to do. Share your life with them and share how joyful it is to know the Lord has taken away my sin. He'll never look at me again as a commandment breaker. I have the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I understand that not necessarily everybody's questions were able to be answered tonight. So Ken, is there a way that if somebody has questions, they can contact either you or somebody else at Reasons to Believe?
Absolutely. You can email questions to reasons.org. You can go on the website. There's a place where you can ask questions. You can get on the mailing list. We spend a lot of our time answering questions of college students.
All right. So thank you all for coming here tonight. And once again, I wanted to thank both the local chapter of Reasons to Believe and the CMAC crew as well. Also, all the volunteers that made this night happen. You guys are all awesome. So you guys have a wonderful night. And for Church on Thursdays, I'll see you guys next week. Have a wonderful night.
Tonight, we had a great opportunity to have a forum with Dr. Ken Samples.
All right. So as a pastor of People's Church, why would you want to bring somebody like Ken Samples to a Thursday night college gathering?
Well, on a weekly basis, we gather together as a community. We dig into God's Word. We ask questions. And somebody like Ken just brings years of experience. He's educated. He's written a lot on topics and questions, especially those that are 18 to 20-something that they're asking. Their worldviews are being formed, and that's exactly what we were able to do tonight. We were able to expand the conversation, deepen our understanding of our faith, and especially ask questions that we just happen to know that our young adults are asking.
All right, so then last question for you personally, Brent. What was the benefit that you've gained from this evening, from both the message that Ken gave and also the question and answer time as well?
You know, when I was thinking about tonight, I was listening to Ken talk about a question was asked during our Q&A time. Yeah, what would make a person want to be an apologist? And I've just recently returned from spending 10 days in Israel, where I was immersed in the Jewish culture. And I was re-reminded yet again of the debate culture that's there and how everyone has opinions and thoughts. And I was, you know, as a culture, we here in the West, we don't quite know what to do with that. But in other parts of the world, especially the Middle East, it's very cultural to at times passionately disagree, but to do so that in love. And so this evening, I know me personally, I was encouraged by Ken to not be afraid to engage and to push back, but to push back in love. And you know, hey, if you're right, but you're grumpy, how good is that, right? So I love Ken's humor this evening. I love how he spoke the truth in love. And I'm looking forward personally to seeing how this evening is going to be impacting me in my life.
All right. Thank you, Brent. So I have one of the attendees that came here to the Reasons to Believe event. What is your name, and what was one thing that really stood out to you tonight about the presentation?
My name is Emily, and one thing that really stood out to me tonight was someone had asked a question about the importance of the forgiveness of sin and trying to explain the need for a Savior to someone who doesn't understand the full weight of sin. And Professor Samples just kind of talked about the need for identifying the own sin, your own sins in your life, and just being willing to communicate those to the people that are looking for answers, and also identifying sins not only of outward appearance but also of your heart.
Thank you. So, Pastor Professor Ken, he's an apologist. Is apologetics something that you've heard of, and is it something that you would be interested in learning about?
Yes, I have heard of apologetics, and I'm definitely interested in it, in explaining your faith and just being able to communicate in words to those who need to believe and who need a Savior.
Thank you, Emily. All right, so what is your name, and what is one thing about this evening that that really stood out to you? Maybe it was a question or something that Ken said in his presentation.
Yes, hello, Trevor. My name is Cliff Wilson, and the thing that I enjoyed most tonight is that it is a good thing as believers in Jesus Christ to be able to think and to know that we have answers that go far beyond just the simplicity of life. And it was a good thing to hear Ken expound upon that and to really give us reasons why to believe and why things the way they are and the different processes that we go through in thinking and how to do it critically and to analyze something and to know that what we see and what we understand is good enough, and that we just need to speak it forth. But we also need to know. We need to be prepared for when we are asked a question, to be able to give a good defense, and to do it in a very practical and real way, and not feel like we're missing something, or that we need to have something that goes beyond what we understand and know.
So is there a family member or even a friend that you think that an event just like this would be beneficial to them?
Yes, actually, I received an email about this event tonight, but I also had a cousin of mine call me and say, hey, you know what? They wanted to go to this event, so we came together. So with that, though, but even this would be something that I think that any family member that I have, even my son or my daughters, would benefit greatly from this, and it is a very good thing.
All right. Thank you, Cliff Wilson. All right, so what is your name, and what were some thoughts you had about the evening?
I'm Fernicia Williams, and I thought tonight was really interesting. There was a lot of information that I've never heard before or heard from that perspective, so I'm happy that I got to hear it, and definitely gave me a lot to think about, and I'm excited to go forward looking at new things.
And are there some resources you learned about tonight that either you or that you will recommend to somebody to check out about either Reasons to Believe or about apologetics as well?
Well, definitely look at the website. I think there's a lot on there that I can gain more information from, and I can show people who I know as well that may have questions about it also.
Perfect. Thank you, Fernicia. All right, so I have Ben here. And Ben, what was one of the things that you that you kind of really pulled out of the service? What is one thing that stood out to you?
Well, it kind of brought me back, because I used to think a lot more about the science behind God. And lately, it's been more about just a connection, a personal like relationship with Him. And this kind of brought that back, and just kind of opened up in more different ways and paths of thinking about God, and ways God works in our minds and into groups of people and in individuals, and just all the different ways he's a creator.
All right, so as a college age student, is apologetics something that you've heard about, and is it something that you would be interested in studying further?
Yeah, I've heard of apologetics before, and I've always thought they were pretty interesting, especially since growing up I was pretty argumentative, and I used to be kind of into that. But yeah, I actually am probably going to go check out the website, and it was an interesting experience. It was fun listening to it. It was thought-provoking, and it was good.
All right. Thank you, Ben.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
All right.